Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this evening's talk here at the American Turkish Friendship Association, or simply known as ATFA or ATFA. I want to welcome Ambassador David Shinn to this evening's talk, of course. He will present information regarding the research in his latest book called Hizmet Movement in Africa, The Activities and Significance of the Gulen Movement. A brief bio about Ambassador Shinn. He's been teaching at the Elliott School of International Affairs at George Washington University since 2001. He served as a diplomat for 37 years as part of the US Foreign Service with assignments in the embassies in Lebanon, Kenya, Tanzania, Cameroon, Sudan, and as the ambassador to Burkina Faso and Ethiopia. The author of numerous books and chapters, book chapters, articles in academic and policy journals. He's also the co-author of a book, China and Africa, A Century of Engagement, and an historical dictionary of Ethiopia. He serves as an advisor to or on half a dozen non-governmental organization boards. Ambassador David Shinn has a PhD in political science from George Washington University and also has a blog to which you should have the details of. So today's talk is primarily based around this book, Hizmet in Africa. You will have an opportunity to purchase this after the event. It's available at the back of the hall. And before we commence, I actually want to, my friends here at the ATFA have asked me to remind the audience of two current projects, or they're really one, but interrelated. There is a current Syria blanket and coat drive, so please keep this in mind. If you don't have the information, by all means, our friends here at ATFA. And related to that, there's also a gala dinner. But the coat drive ends December 5, blanket and coat drive. This has been a successful project that's run by ATFA. We're a partner to that. When I say we, the Rumi Forum, so we welcome your contributions. Nothing easier than giving really a blanket. And of course, you know what the cause is. But they're accepting blankets, coats, and of course, if that's too difficult, you're more than welcome to donate cash as well. So without further ado, I want to welcome Ambassador Shinn. We had the pleasure of working on this book, particularly in regards to the travel. We went to some seven or eight countries in Africa. I'll leave it at that. I may interject, but you'll all have an opportunity to ask questions at the end, so please do so. And again, welcome, Ambassador Shinn.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Amre. Everyone hear me okay? Any problem? Okay. Let me just say a word or two about the genesis of this book. Amre was very generous in his biography of me. The book really was a suggestion that this gentleman over here made. I had attended several events at the Rumi Forum in Washington, and at one point Emre took me aside and asked if I would be willing to do, as I understood it, a paper on the Hizmet movement in Africa. So I was thinking of a relatively modest project of maybe 20 or 30 pages, and I agreed to do it. Well, little did I know that what he really had in mind was a book, which turned out to be a two-year project. And the result of that effort is on the back table. I did have a few ground rules that I laid down. One, that I have total editorial control over whatever it was that I produced, and that I would accept no reimbursement for the book. The Rumi Forum, or at least financing arranged by the Rumi Forum, did cover the travel expenses for two trips to Africa and one trip to Turkey. So that was covered by expenses other than what I put into this, but all of the time devoted to the book was my own volunteer time. The material was collected, as Emre suggested, in one major way, and that was a trip to 7 different countries in Africa, South Africa, Tanzania, Kenya, Ethiopia, Nigeria, Senegal, and Morocco, plus a trip to Turkey, actually 2 trips to Turkey. I had done an earlier trip to Turkey under the sponsorship of the Rumi Forum. So there were 2 trips to Turkey involved in this. And the analysis is based heavily upon interviews that I conducted during the visits to both Africa and Turkey. There's very little published material available on what the Gulen movement or Hizmet is doing in Africa. A few monographs, a few short articles, no books, a lot of journalistic accounts, mainly in Zaman Today. And I should point out that I am not an expert on Turkey. My area of expertise is Africa. I've had to learn a lot about Turkey in the last 4 or 5 years, but that's not my area of expertise. I don't know the internal issues of Turkey at all, well at all. But I do feel comfortable applying to Africa the Hizmet movement. I should emphasize that there are 54 countries in Africa, and this book tries to deal with all 54 in a very general way. And as a result, I'm covering both the countries of sub-Saharan Africa and those of North Africa, although the emphasis is obviously on sub-Saharan. There are far more of them. And nearly all of the Hizmet activity in Africa has taken place in the last 20 years, basically since the late 1990s. And in fact, most of it has really taken place in the last 10 years. So we're talking about a very recent phenomenon in Africa. I realize that Hizmet has a longer history in some other parts of the world, but in Africa it's essentially 20 years old. I want to very quickly go through the chapters of the book, and I'll just spend a minute or two on each one. The first chapter is simply an introduction to the overall book. The chapter 2 tries to look at Fethullah Gulen, the person, and his Islamic philosophy, drawing on the writings and the analysis done by many experts, not by me. I'm not an expert on Fethullah Gulen, but there are a lot of people who have written extensively about him, and I have drawn on their research. The chapter also discusses Hizmet from a global perspective and touches on the major criticisms of this social phenomenon. And if you go to the internet, you will find plenty of criticism, as I'm sure you all are aware. Chapter 3 focuses on Hizmet's global commercial arm, particularly Tuscan. It describes the activities of Tuscan in Africa and analyzes the importance of Hizmet business organizations and in individual African countries. A couple of examples, and there are many that we encountered in our travels. The Association of Businessmen and Investors of Nigeria and Turkey, the South African Turkish Business Association. These are Hizmet, local Hizmet organizations based on businessmen in countries in Africa. Their primary task is to organize African business delegations to visit Turkey and to host visiting Turkish business delegations coming from Turkey. Not surprisingly, Tuscan and the Hizmet-affiliated business groups tend to focus on the stronger and the larger countries in Africa, particularly countries like and economies like Morocco, Nigeria, Ghana, Ethiopia, South Africa, and Angola. But they don't ignore the smaller countries of Africa, countries like Mauritius, Gabon, and even Somalia, where Turkey as a government and Hizmet as an organization both have major programs. The chapter also covers efforts to develop Islamic banking in Africa, which has temporarily come to an end because of pressures the government has put on Bank Asya in Turkey, and the Islamic banking component in Africa was a component of Bank Asya. One of the most significant aspects of my research relates to the unusual business model that Hizmet has adopted. And effectively, you have the Turkish business community, those members who are supporters of the Gulen movement, who believe in the ideals of Hizmet, providing seed money for various projects scattered all over Africa, particularly the schools or the dialogue centers. They provide the initial funding, and the schools afterwards become a self-funding organization by the payment of fees. And the advantage that the business community obtains from the schools is that the schools attract the sons and daughters of significant local African business persons, local civil servants. The parents are very much engaged in the schools. That's part of the philosophy of the schools. The businessmen then have open access to the parents of the children attending the school. So it's a very different business model. I don't use the term business model in a pejorative sense at all. I use it in a very practical sense. It's a way that the Turkish business representatives can, in effect, get some return on their investment in Hizmet. The first school in Africa opened actually in Tangier in 1994. It was a little bit of an outlier. There were several years went by before you had another school appear in sub-Saharan Africa. But in terms of the first on the continent, it would be Tangier in 1994. The first one to open in sub-Saharan Africa was in Senegal in 1997, followed a year later by schools in Kenya, Tanzania, and Nigeria. And it was interesting, as we traveled around Africa and went to these schools in Kenya, Tanzania, and Nigeria, they were all claiming to be the first school. In fact, it's Senegal, which has a year ahead of all of the others. But the schools are not centrally registered. There's not a great deal of discussion between the principals of the different schools. And so they don't even necessarily know what the starting dates are of other schools on the continent, nor do they even necessarily know where they are on the continent. Today, there are well over 100 schools in 35 African countries and one full-fledged university in Nigeria. About half of the schools have opened in the past 10 years in order to underscore the relative recency of this social movement. Most of the schools are found in African countries that are predominantly Muslim or have a Muslim minority of at least 10%. Now, in Africa, it's important to understand that just under 50% of the population of all of Africa is Muslim, probably around 47-48%. This includes North Africa, but it also includes all of sub-Saharan Africa. So one should not be surprised, since most of the population is in sub-Saharan Africa, with a percentage of 47-48% Muslim across the continent, to find significant Muslim minorities in most other African countries. And of course, some are Muslim majority. A country like Somalia is probably 99.9% Muslim. Countries like Niger, Mali, Senegal, Chad are overwhelmingly Muslim. So you have a very large Islamic population in Africa. Now, the exceptions to a significant Muslim population are a few countries like South Africa, which has a Muslim population of perhaps only 3, 4, maximum 5%, although it's a large country, so even 3 or 4% of South Africa's population is a fairly large Muslim population. Angola has almost no Muslim population. And there are a number of other countries that have very, very tiny Muslim populations. Except for Morocco, Arab North Africa has not been especially receptive to Hizmet schools. There are no schools in Algeria and Tunisia, and Libya only opened its first school in 2012. So you have an interesting phenomenon where most of the Hizmet activity, at least in terms of schools, is in sub-Saharan Africa, and including some countries with a Muslim population of maybe only 10, 20, 30%. The schools are usually known by the Africans as Turkish schools. They are seldom linked to Hizmet or the Gulen movement by Africans, including the Africans who actually have children in the school. None of the schools have the name Hizmet in the title or the name Gulen in the title. They all have very, very different kinds of titles, like the Star International in South Africa, the Light Academy in Kenya, the Groupe Scolaire Safak in Côte d'Ivoire, and the École Internationale Turco-Congolaise in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. As I say, the word Gulen never appears in the name of the school. In a number of African countries, the Hizmet schools actually preceded the establishment of the Turkish embassy in the country. Now, not all countries by any means, but there are a number of countries where you had a Hizmet school before you had a Turkish embassy. Now, Turkey now has 39 embassies in Africa. It has significantly expanded its diplomatic representation in the continent. Turkey has more embassies in Africa than does India, or Brazil, or some really major countries around the world, because the government of Turkey has put such an emphasis on extending its diplomatic representation there. But when Hizmet began 20 years ago in Africa, I think Turkey had only about 7 or 8 embassies in Africa. In a number of the African countries, the Hizmet schools not only preceded the Turkish embassy, but they tended to be helpful to the government of Turkey when Turkey was setting up an embassy. If Turkey had no other presence in the country at the time that it wanted to establish an embassy and Hizmet had a school in the country, they would naturally go to the school and seek support frequently for finding out how you get things done in the country. The Turkish business community that's sympathetic to Hizmet provides the seed money for establishing the schools. The schools then operate on a fee-paying basis, and they are expected to cover all the costs once the school gets underway. Some schools turn a profit, which is used to expand the number of schools or to upgrade the existing facilities. The schools allow the national curriculum in each country and do not offer Islamic education except for one branch of schools in South Africa, where you had a very special arrangement where Hizmet took over a previously Islamic system, and they do teach, their focus is on Islam, and they do teach in an Islamic manner. The main language of instruction is the principal language of instruction in the country where the schools are located, usually English or French, occasionally Portuguese. Turkish is almost always, in fact it is always, offered as an option for one of the foreign languages. The schools have been highly praised by a wide range of African officials and African business persons whose sons and daughters usually provide most of the students at the schools. The Turkish business persons who support the schools benefit from the contacts they get through the parents of the children in the school. It tends to be a symbiotic relationship. The book identifies by name and date of establishment most of the schools that exist throughout Africa. It discusses in greater depth the schools in 5 countries: South Africa, Kenya, Nigeria, Senegal, and Morocco. Now, the listing of schools that I have in the book is by far the most complete listing that has ever been compiled publicly, but I'm sure there are omissions from it because it's not possible to visit all 54 countries. So we tried to identify every school on the continent, but in some cases it's simply not possible. The principal criticism that I encountered of the schools is that some of the Turkish teachers did not have a sufficient command of French or English, depending upon the language of the country in which they were teaching. Finally, the chapter on the schools discusses the evolving relationship between the government of Turkey and the Hizmet schools in Africa. The challenges in the past several years that Hizmet has experienced in Turkey have been extended to Africa. The government has actually, the government of Turkey has tried to force the closure of schools. In a number of countries in Africa, the only country that's succeeded in doing so that I'm aware of is in Gambia, where one school was closed, although it may have reopened under another name. Chapter 5 documents and analyzes the significance of Hizmet's small dialogue centers in African cities. Now, these organizations overtly propagate the ideas of Fethullah Gulen, but his name never appears in the title of the organization itself. They go by different names, such as the Turquoise Harmony Institute in South Africa, the Kilimanjaro Dialogue Center in Tanzania, the Respect Foundation in Kenya, the Ufuk Dialogue Foundation in Nigeria, and the Atlantique Turquie-Senegal Association pour le Dialogue Culturel entre les Civilisations in Senegal. I don't know why Senegal has to have such a long name, but I think that they'd fall asleep before they got to the end of the title of their organization. Niloufer in Morocco, and the Egyptian-Turkish Friendship and Culture Association, obviously in Egypt. And these are effectively the counterparts of the Rumi Forum in Washington. They are smaller, have been around for fewer number of years, and are sort of less embedded in the society than is the Rumi Forum, for obvious reasons. They work closely with the Gulen-affiliated and Istanbul-based Journalists and Writers Foundation. Most countries do not have a dialogue center. They tend to exist in countries where Turkish business interests are more significant. As a result, the chapter discusses in greater detail the dialogue centers in South Africa, Tanzania, Kenya, Nigeria, Senegal, Morocco, and Egypt. They are active in interfaith dialogue activities and work especially closely with the Catholic Church in those countries that have a strong Catholic Church. Hizmet has its own global humanitarian arm, known as Kimsi Akmu, which is especially active in Africa because the need is great in Africa. Chapter 6 evaluates Kimsi Akmu, both its structure and its organization, the value of its aid to Africa, and especially its largest programs in Sudan, Somalia, Uganda, Ethiopia, and Kenya. In 2013, Kimsi Akmu distributed about $17.5 million of assistance to 43 countries in Africa. Most of the aid went to small development projects in the fields of health, education, water wells, and support for orphans. The chapter also identifies several smaller affiliated Hizmet programs that operate out of Turkey or the Turkish diaspora in Europe. These programs rely entirely on private donations and volunteer contributions. There has been no support from the government of Turkey. The programs are concentrated in Muslim areas of Africa, but some non-Muslims are also recipients of the assistance. Chapter 7 explains how the Gulen movement has mastered the media as a variety of print and TV outlets, most of them based in Turkey or the United States. The dialogue centers distribute the print media and are working to expand Hizmet's television operation. The English language magazine The Fountain is published in New Jersey and distributed globally. The Arabic language Hira is published primarily in Egypt. The French language Ebru magazine originates in Istanbul and has content similar to The Fountain, and all of these publications emphasize the philosophy of Gulen. The Gulen-affiliated daily papers, the Turkish language Zaman and the English language Zaman Today, have minimal readership in Africa. It's simply a problem of circulating them there. And of course, Turkish would have very little relevance to Africa. Hizmet has its own Sihan news agency with some limited staff in Africa. Hizmet has operated Ebru TV out of New Jersey since 2006, but only made a serious effort to penetrate the African market in 2012 when it opened an office in Nairobi. The Arabic language Hira TV began in 2014 as an internet-only broadcast. Chapter 8 assesses the impact of the movement's programs on policies in Africa by the Turkish government and the ruling AKP. It begins with the early and generally friendly relationship between Hizmet and the AKP. It moves to the high point of the relationship and then the development of cracks between Hizmet and the AKP. The chapter concludes with a discussion of the factors that led to a breakup of the relationship and the impact of the breakup on Hizmet in Africa. My assessment is that African leaders want, on the one hand, to avoid offending the government of Turkey by cooperating too closely with Hizmet activities. On the other hand, the Africans do not want to be told that what they can and cannot do by any foreign government, including the government of Turkey. The government of Turkey has limited leverage in sub-Saharan Africa, where Hizmet is strongest. So far, African governments seem to be allowing Hizmet programs to continue undisturbed. Chapter 9, final chapter, analyzes the overall impact of Hizmet and the philosophy of Fethullah Gulen in Africa. While the impact has been modest in sub-Saharan Africa, it has been disproportionately significant compared to the limited human and financial resources that its supporters have invested there. It is almost impossible at this early stage to measure the degree to which Fethullah Gulen's values are impacting African society. It is just too recent. Graduates of Hizmet-affiliated schools are only beginning to assume positions of authority in Africa. And I conclude the book by discussing briefly the interaction of Hizmet and Islam in Africa, the challenges of Hizmet operations in Arab North Africa, where the challenges are clearly greater, Hizmet and African extremist movements, and Hizmet in Africa after Gulen. So that concludes my remarks, and I'd be very happy to take any questions that you might have.
Thank you, Ambassador Shinn. I'll just, in passing, I recall our visit to Kaduna in northern Nigeria. I'm not sure if you remember the visit to the school there. And it was interesting that it was striking for me. The State Department actually had a warning for people not to visit Nigeria at that time.
Well, not to visit northern Nigeria.
And then, if I remember, which was going to be my next statement, specifically not to visit northern Nigeria, which is what we ended up doing. And though there wasn't a dialogue center in that area, the school almost functioned as one by virtue of the relationships they built with the local clergy and pastors, to the degree that one or two of them said if it hadn't been for this school, there would be no way that my people, or in particular myself, we would be able to enter mosques or be in dialogue, and similarly for our Turkish friends here, for them to come to into our churches, because during that period, there were many people of Muslim background attacking churches, people of Christian background attacking mosques. So that's something that stood out for me in terms of some of the values that had been cross-shared between the Hizmet members as well as the Christian clergy. Not too sure if you want to add anything to that, but this was something that comes to mind when I think of this book and what we did.
Sure. Kaduna is in northern Nigeria. It's overwhelmingly Muslim in the Kaduna area, but there is a Christian minority that also lives there. And Kaduna is sort of on the fringe of where Boko Haram is active, and that was the nature of the problem. Boko Haram had been active in not distant times in the Kaduna area, creating real havoc vis-a-vis the non-Muslim population, and even attacking Muslims, for that matter. Boko Haram doesn't seem to have any compunction about killing Muslims, just as they kill Christians. And that was the nature of the issue there. The Hizmet school in Kaduna was functioning normally, and the principals of the school indicated they had no problems in running the school. Throughout the time when Boko Haram posed a threat, which technically it still does today, although it's the focus of Boko Haram has moved further north and east in Nigeria. And since we visited there, it was an area that very much was in harm's way and seems to be, for the moment, at least out of harm's way, but that could change. I think Emre is right. The relationship between the Hizmet community in Kaduna and the Christian population there was a very cordial one.
I'll take it to the audience now. If you've got a question, I ask that you stand in a loud, clear voice. You may provide your name and your affiliation. We would welcome that. Otherwise, please, if you have any questions, raise your hand. Yes, sir, at the back.
My name is Sadik. I came from Iowa. I'm just a guest here and glad to hear your talk. Thank you very much for your efforts. And we were, in fact, planning to have a trip to Africa for the next coming summer. So it was very, a great opportunity for me to learn more about the continent. My question is regarding the other non-profit organizations in the Africa. We all know that there are many, many organizations serving the people of Africa. And how would you distinguish the Hizmet movement activities comparing with those other organizations?
Did everyone hear the question okay?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. First, you would have to make the distinction that most organizations functioning in Africa that are of a humanitarian nature or trying to help in some way obtain most of their funding from some government or some international organization. Now, there are a few that would not fit that category, but not very many. The vast majority of humanitarian efforts in Africa today, including the non-governmental organizations, they ultimately get most of their money from some government or combination of governments or some international agency. And the difference with Hizmet is that as far as I can tell, all of the funding that goes into it is coming from the business, usually the Turkish business community. There may be occasional small donations from local businessmen, African businessmen who are supportive of the concept, but the vast majority of it is coming from the Turkish business community, either in Africa on the one hand, or some of it would be coming directly from Turkey, particularly that which supports Kimse Yakmu, which would be supported by an even wider variety of Turkish nationals. They wouldn't have to be business people, they could be individuals who simply donate to Kimse Yakmu. But the organizations in Africa itself, I would venture to guess, at least 90% of all the funding comes from the donations from the business community. So in that sense, it's a very different structure than other organizations have. Other differences would be the overhead structure, the administrative overhead of any Hizmet organization is always very modest. Some international organizations, some non-governmental organizations have a very heavy administrative overhead, complete with a fleet of land cruisers and everything else. And an awful lot of what they do tends to be chewed up with administrative overhead. And this is also true of government aid organizations. They're very, very heavy on overhead costs. And I would give Hizmet a great deal of credit for a huge reliance upon volunteer effort, including members of the business community who while they are trying to make a living manufacturing something or selling something or offering a service, might spend part of a weekend volunteering for some kind of Hizmet project or doing something at the school, volunteering there. So there's a bigger volunteer component than virtually any other organization I'm familiar with in Africa. There might be organizations elsewhere around the world that have a similar volunteer component, but I would say this is not, although it may not be unique to Hizmet, it's very, very unusual to see such a heavy volunteer component. You might see that a heavier volunteer component back in your home country. I mean, there are American volunteer organizations where people truly volunteer, but not that many where they go overseas and continue the volunteer effort.
Any other questions? Yes, Paul.
Paul Wee is my name. Elliott School, George Washington University. Just coming back to Kaduna, there is the Christian Muslim Christian Dialogue Center of Kaduna. Muhammad Ashafa and James Wuye been really honored by the United Nations. Is that the same? I mean, they have got now 4,000 young people, Muslims and Christians, who have this beautiful relationship, and they go around in Plateau State and Kaduna State into the villages, and I've had the chance to travel with them several times. Unbelievable. Is this the same?
It's the same concept and the same idea, but different people involved. I'm familiar with them and their activity, and that is arguably a bigger effort in Kaduna itself, or in the immediate Kaduna area, than what Hizmet is doing there. What Hizmet is doing is working with local Muslim and Christian church people in order to try to establish a better kind of a dialogue. But it's pretty much confined to the town of Kaduna itself, and as far as I know, it does not extend beyond that. What you're talking about is a most unusual initiative anywhere in the world, and certainly in Africa. I don't know of any other group where a prominent Christian and Muslim leader have gotten together to do just exactly what they do. It's really quite unique, and that's why it's attracted so much publicity, because it is so unique.
We got a question here, sir. Yes, please.
Aligokche, you're an expert on Africa, and now you know the Hizmet way of working and Hizmet schools. Where do you see these schools like in 20 years or 50 years in Africa?
To some extent, the answer to your question is going to depend upon the degree to which the Hizmet movement is not harassed by the government, and particularly on the funding end. If there are serious pressures put on funding, and I don't fully understand all the intricacies as to how the funding is handled, but clearly there have been efforts to make difficulties for Bank Asia, and there have been efforts to even shut down the schools in Africa. The efforts to cause problems for Bank Asia seem to have had some considerable success. That doesn't directly impact volunteer efforts for the Hizmet movement, but it probably complicates some of it in terms of transferring of funds, for example. It's impossible for me to judge where the government is going with its program aimed at Hizmet. It seems to have become even harsher in recent weeks. Where it ends up, I don't know. If it becomes even harsher than it's already been, it would seem to me that could have a negative impact on funding and support. And if that happens, that's going to slow down the progress of the movement and the expansion of the movement. I think it will be much harder to impact what Hizmet is doing in sub-Saharan Africa than it is in Turkey, for example. I mean, the government of Turkey just doesn't have that much reach as far as Africa is concerned. But if it puts some obstacles in the way of transferring funds or even attracting funding, particularly from Turkey, then it's going to have the tendency of slowing down the expansion of Hizmet in Africa. Should that situation change, and should Hizmet be allowed to sort of go back to the way it operated 3-4 years ago, then I would see a very much of a continued expansion of the movement, certainly throughout Africa. I can't speak to the movement in Turkey. That's not what I follow. I just follow it in Africa. But I would very much see an expansion in Africa. But I think an awful lot's going to be determined upon the policy of the government of Turkey in the coming years.
Yes, sir.
I was wondering whether you were able to perceive similarities as well as differences between Hizmet-affiliated organizations and other religiously affiliated groups, whether Catholic or Methodist or Lutheran, seems to be many of them are missionary oriented, and they're out to convert people to their faith or to do some other socially valid work in the area.
I think there are more differences between Hizmet and these other organizations than there are similarities. Clearly, there is an element of trying to attract followers to all of these organizations. It's quite subtle in the case of Hizmet, far more subtle than it is with any, I think, established religious organization or any church or whatever faith we might be talking about. In that, I don't see it as a missionary effort per se, but yet it is trying to encourage a philosophy of a particular individual in a manner of sort of following by doing to some extent. That's the way the schools tend to operate. It was interesting in visiting schools, and we visited many of them, that there did not seem to be any sort of overt effort to preach the principles of Fethullah Gulen, yet there were subtle messages that would be conveyed by the teachers because they were followers, and they would convey those messages by doing. The discipline that was maintained in the schools was part of this, and no smoking, no alcohol, no drugs, and the Hizmet schools are very strict on that. And you go to a Hizmet school and you violate one of those, I assume you're out. I mean, that's the end of it. That message maybe isn't quite so subtle, but the point gets across very quickly that that's just not allowed in the concept of their schools. But I see this as all rather different than what, say, the Catholic Church does or evangelical Protestant churches do. Certainly different than the Salafist approach, which is can be very draconian. In fact, the Hizmet movement tends to be in Islam tends to be the pole opposite of Wahhabism and Salafism, and it's one of the reasons that the two organizations don't get along very well. Hizmet does rather poorly in those countries where there is a very strong Wahhabi or Salafi influence in the country, because they're not very accepting of Fethullah Gulen's Sufi ideas, philosophy. But as I say, more differences than there are similarities, I think, between these organizations. The other major difference is that Hizmet is so decentralized. It's not a top-down structure. I mean, the Catholic Church has a pope, and you pretty much know what the guidelines are supposed to be, not that all Catholics follow them. But Hizmet has nothing that is similar to that. I mean, Gulen does not operate as, quote, as the Pope would. It's just a totally different concept. And even mainline Protestant churches, they're more structured than Hizmet is organized.
Yes, please.
My name is Rose Marie Annunciata. I just want to know, what is the population of girls in the schools? Mm-hmm. Ratio boys, girls?
With maybe a couple of exceptions, the schools were about 50-50. Now, some of the schools were divided, all girls and all boys, and it might be the same school, but with separate buildings. Some of the schools were strictly co-ed, and it depended upon what the local people wanted. If they wanted a co-ed school, there was a co-ed school. If they wanted an all-boys school or an all-girls school, then that's the way it was set up. The classes that that we observed, I would say, would be about 50-50. And they were also generally representative of the religious background of the community in which they were located. So if the school was in a community that was, say, 50% Christian and 50% Muslim, the school tended to be about 50-50. If the school was in a community that was 100% Muslim, then it's going to be 100% Muslim in the school. I don't think we ever saw any school where it was 100% Christian, but we certainly saw schools that were about 50-50, 45-55, that sort of percentage in terms of religion. But on male, female, pretty much even across the board.
Yes, please, here.
My name's Hannah. I was wondering, I know that you didn't study the role of women as a focus, but I was wondering what your take on the role of women in the Hizmet movement is.
In Africa specifically, in Africa, I suspect?
Specifically, from your study.
Yeah, it's a good question, and I'm not sure I have a very good answer for you. One, as you say, I didn't study that specifically, and all I know is what I know anecdotally. Clearly, Hizmet has a conservative approach to women, maybe not all that conservative in the context of Islam, but in the context of my Western mind, non-Muslim Western mind, strikes me as very conservative. And one that sometimes I had a little trouble adjusting to, let me say. And I think that was reflected with the Hizmet women in Africa that I encountered. But I certainly didn't sense any exclusion and there were teachers in the school, there were women teachers in the school, both Turkish and non-Turkish. So that wasn't an area of concern for me, but I have to admit it's a different approach to how males and females interact than what I've grown up with in the United States. So in that sense, it was sometimes a bit of an awakening for me. Although I've had a number of tours in countries that are overwhelmingly Muslim, and I've seen this in other Islamic societies where Hizmet is not a factor at all. In a place like Mauritania, it's overwhelmingly Muslim. In Sudan, where we served, it's predominantly Muslim. And the way women are treated in these countries is frankly quite different. Mauritania is far more conservative towards women than Sudan was, of all places. Sudan was surprisingly open to women. But, these are nuances of religion that, to a Westerner, are different. Let me leave it at that.
And you had a question, please?
Yeah, I have a question. I was wondering, you mentioned there is more Hizmet schools in more Christian populated areas than Muslim populated areas.
If I said that, I misspoke. There are more in sub-Saharan Africa. There are more countries, I think this is accurate, that are predominantly Christian, but with large Muslim minorities. And as a result, you probably have more schools in more African countries that have a 51% or more Christian presence. But in terms of where the schools are actually located, there are clearly more schools in predominantly Muslim communities in Africa, that I'm sure of. But there are some schools, not a lot, but some, that are in areas that are at least 50% Christian. And as a result, the student body will reflect that. It'll be about 50-50 Muslim-Christian.
Any other questions? Because I have a few myself, please.
Yeah, I have one small question. My name is Mustafa. You being as an expert like in Hizmet like movement in Africa, so we know that like Hizmet is in Africa for kind of to lower the to increase the education and to help like people to end the poverty and like solve the disharmony things. So can it be promoted by other countries as like Turkish government is not really like kind of blocking the Hizmet movement, but like, and also on the media we know that most of the major countries they try to help to African countries like to develop them, so Hizmet it seems kind of positive thing, so can it be promoted by big countries like
what do you mean outside of Africa?
Or
other countries in Africa don't...
Not like other countries in Africa, like United States. Like how does United States, like government of United States perceive the Hizmet movement in Africa? Or can it be helped to end the poverty in Africa? Or
I mean, in effect, are you asking whether a government like the United States could in effect help fund Hizmet?
Cooperating
in what way? Can you give me an example of what cooperation would consist of?
Like trying to help, like open up more schools or kind of promote Hizmet in Africa, like more openly.
Okay, I think I understand where you're going with it. And I'd be very frank on this point. I think that would be a huge mistake for Hizmet. Hizmet does as well as it does because it is an indigenous movement that attracts followers for whatever reasons it does, and it has no external support or financing, including from the Turkish government. And I think that is the strength of the organization. I think once it looks like it has been captured by any foreign government, or the Turkish government for that matter, I think it would be probably the end of Hizmet over the long term. Hizmet already has the problem where if you go to the internet, there are those who say, Hizmet is nothing more than the creation of the Central Intelligence Agency, for example. I mean, this is all nonsense, we know, but that is exactly the kind of thing you don't want to lend any credence whatsoever to by having some kind of official support for, even if it's only rhetorical support. That would be the end of Hizmet. I think you have the right idea now in terms of an organization that stands on its own and works because of the volunteer effort behind it. And you just don't want it. You don't want to corrupt it with anyone or anything. So that would be my response to what you're suggesting. I mean, obviously, you want to have people who sympathize with the organization and say nice things about you. But beyond that, I would keep it home.
One last question from the back before I.
Hi, my name is Hassan. I was born in Tehran. And for me, it's not clear what the mission of Hizmet is. If you have a mission statement that for somebody that knows nothing about this movement, when you say that, I'd like to hear it.
I'm going to let you answer that. The next hour.
Okay, this is a very brief summary. And there's probably another book event for that. Someone's book. Basically, in essence, the mission of the Hizmet movement is about overcoming three important social ills. These were inspired in Gulen through a very important Muslim scholar, Said Nursi, who spoke about the social ills in the Muslim world, be they poverty, disunity, and ignorance. That it was incumbent on Muslims to help solve these problems in the Muslim world. This is the maxim of Nursi. Gulen takes this one very important step further and says that these social ills do not pertain to the Muslim world only. These are the shared social ills of the whole world, and no matter who is suffering, it's incumbent on Muslims originally, now he would diversify. It's incumbent on all people to play a part. So in essence, the name Hizmet, the title Hizmet, means service. So it's around service in overcoming these social ills. And for that reason, Africa is one aspect, but the broader question is the Hizmet movement is now active in close to 160 countries. So that's significant, but I'll end my answer there. So I think in terms of what the movement does, I'm not too sure if you want to add anything specific. I have got one or two brief questions that I'd like to end on. What do you see, David, as domestic challenges? I know you've made inference to things coming out of Turkey, Turkish government, etc. Is there a particular generic theme in terms of challenges, or is it education versus dialogue have different challenges, or is it regional? What are some of the challenges that Hizmet is encountering in either Africa generally or specifically? I leave that to you.
I think there were two that I would cite. One I've already alluded to, and both of them are more general than Africa specific. The one that I've already alluded to is I'm not sure how Hizmet deals with growing Salafism and Wahhabism in the Arab world, particularly. This is a real challenge for a Sufi-based organization, and I think it's already obvious that Hizmet has had difficulties breaking through that. Now, part of that is frankly related to the fact that Hizmet is essentially a Turkish organization, and the whole concept of the Ottoman Empire and the Turkish legacy sometimes doesn't sell well in the Arab world, and that's another challenge, and there's nothing you can do about that. I mean, that's history, and you just have to make the best of a difficult situation in terms of dealing with the Arab world. So I throw that out, but I don't have any solutions to the problem. The other one, there is something of a solution to it, and this is a broader problem that I think faces Hizmet globally, and that's a whole question of transparency. I think Hizmet comes across as not being a particularly transparent organization. I mean, the mere fact that it's impossible to obtain anywhere, at least publicly, a listing of the Hizmet schools around the world strikes me as very much not the 21st century. There may be a good reason why there's no listing of the schools, but the difficulty that I had putting together a list just for Africa and knowing that even that is not totally accurate and complete tells you a lot. And somewhere, someone seemingly knows where these schools are. Maybe not. Maybe no one in the world knows where all of these schools are located. I mean, that's possible, I suppose. But it certainly is possible for someone to make a decision that we really should have a list. And maybe we even ought to make it public. And I think that would help deal with the transparency issue, for example. And it goes beyond the schools, although that's the most obvious one, because that's the biggest single component of the sort of practical side of what Hizmet does around the world, and the best known feature of what Hizmet does. And all you've got to do is go to the internet and look at all the nonsense that appears there, including on the schools. I mean, there are so-called listings of schools there that aren't even remotely accurate. I mean, they are so hopelessly wrong that it just misleads people. So why not have an accurate listing of the schools and have someone keep it up? You don't have to call the school. You don't have to rename the schools Hizmet schools or Gulen schools. Call them whatever you want to call them. But I think it would contribute to alleviating the problem with transparency more generally.
And one last question, this is particularly because this is being taped, and I think it would be of interest to people in Africa. From your expertise as someone who's a scholar on Africa and your developing expertise on Hizmet in Africa, where do you see his opportunities for Hizmet that you feel they can contribute to, other than what you've already seen? New avenues for them to contribute, again, this could be thematic and or regional, I'm not too sure. Of course, it's a conference question, so I don't expect a completed answer, but one or two areas you feel Hizmet can contribute to that you saw that they're not necessarily doing so currently.
This is not really a new area. It's an area that Hizmet is already doing, but it's one that I think, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, has far more potential to it than Hizmet has been able to do so far, mainly because of lack of staffing and funding. And that's the whole concept of interfaith dialogue. Now, I realize that's a core concept of what you already do, but I think that there's an enormous room for doing more of that in Africa to very useful purpose. And the religious conflicts in Africa today are, some of them are frightening. You go to the Central African Republic, where for all practical purposes, there is a religious war going on. It's a predominantly Christian country, but with a significant Muslim minority. And frankly, they're each trying to create genocide against the other. It's just that simple. Now, I'm not suggesting that Hizmet can go into the Central African Republic and stop this religious genocide that's going on, But I think with putting more effort into this, if the funding could be found, you could identify two or three targets, two or three areas in Africa that you could really focus your activity, and you could have an impact. Paul was talking about the effort in the Kaduna area. I think that's probably had an impact on why Boko Haram has been really not very successful in the Kaduna area. It's been very successful in other parts of northern Nigeria. But if you can focus on an area, get highly committed leadership of both the Muslim community, the Christian community, and any other communities that are there. There are a lot of animist communities in Africa still, people who follow local religions. Maybe bring them into it. I think a lot of good could be done. So not a new idea, but there isn't a lot of that being done in sub-Saharan Africa now because of shortage of personnel and financing.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Dave for coming to speak. David will be signing books at the back of the hall here. Again, as a reminder, we've got the Syrian blanket and coat drive, so keep that in mind, as well as the gala dinner. And we look forward to hosting you sometime soon, again, on one of our events. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a lovely evening.
Thank you.